Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning.
Hey everybody, and welcome. We're so thankful that you decided to join us for this morning's message, where Dr. Michael Moss is going to remind us that even though sometimes it's in the most unexpected of ways, we serve a God who always provides. We truly hope this message will encourage you to draw closer to God in this time, that it will encourage you to be a light in the world around you, and that it will equip you as we continue to navigate this unprecedented and uniquely challenging time. Before we get to Mike's message, we ask you to join us in a word of prayer. Father, right now we just want to say thank you first and foremost. Father, we thank you for everything that you do on a daily basis. Father, we thank you for the things that we forget to think about. We thank you for the things that get lost in the shuffle and the confusion. Father, we thank you for the things that we disregard when we're feeling anxious, when we're feeling sad, when we're feeling isolated, when we're feeling lonely. Father, we're thankful that we are united with you and with our brothers and sisters the world over in this moment, in spirit and in truth. Father, as we dig into your word and we receive this message, Father, I ask that you would open our eyes and open our hearts to be receptive to what your spirit has to say to us. Father, I ask that you would strengthen each and every one who is tuning in, and even those who are not, Lord God, all of your children the world over. As we go through this time, Father God, we say thank you for revealing yourself in so many ways that we never considered before. We thank you for drawing us together. We thank you for chipping away the things that divide us. We thank you for removing distractions from us, Lord God, and we ask that you would continue to guide us and help us to focus and dial in on the things that you would have us to focus on and hold most important and prioritize. For this time, Lord God, it is you. And so, Father, in the spirit of thanksgiving and gratitude and awe and wonder, we lift up this prayer to you. We commit this service and this message to you. And we ask that you would continue to go with us. Thank you for always providing, even when we can't see it. We thank you right now, Lord God, for all of this. And we offer it in Christ Jesus' precious name. Amen.
It's good to be with you this morning. We're going to be looking at good old Elijah, and Elijah being fed by the ravens. Sometimes fathers learn a lot from their children. Having three daughters, I had to learn from three daughters. It's really quite interesting because they taught me several things, things that I think we assume as parents we're teaching them, but all the time we're learning a bit as well. Our middle daughter is quite an author. She has at least six books to her name right now. Her first book was called Ode to Grace. It was a historical novel. And then she wrote two books about the adoption of their son Ezra and his one of his birthdays while he was in the U.S. when he really wanted to see some snow, which he'd never seen before. And then she wrote three books that are really designed for middle school students, Believe, Hope, and Remember. And those are really quite interesting. Now she writes every week an article for their local newspaper, and she also has a blog. Our lesson today really comes from her blog, and so I learned a bit from her about that blog. Long ago, when our girls were small, we used to spend time reading Bible stories to them every evening. And one time, while we were reading those Bible stories, that daughter, our middle daughter, said to me, "Dad, it's time that you stop reading those stories. I want you to tell us those stories." And so that's exactly what I started doing, just telling them those wonderful Bible stories. In a very real way, that's what she did in this blog. She told a Bible story, and I decided I would adapt it a bit And I want to tell you a Bible story today. I'm not going to read a lot from this text in 1 Kings chapter 17 and 18, but I'm really going to tell you the story. The story is the story of old Elijah. Elijah is next to a brook, and he is watching the water level get lower and lower. He'd gone to King Ahab and had told King Ahab, there's going to be a drought and it's not going to rain. And in fact, it didn't rain for 3.5 years. And so it's not going to rain. And so God sends him to this brook. And so while he's there, ever since he had told Elijah that there'd be no, told Ahab that there would be no rain, God had sent him to that brook to wait for further instructions. Elijah had been fed by the ravens. And that really is sort of the picture that you see now. He's being fed by the ravens. The ravens are going to bring him bread and meat every morning, and every evening he'll get the bread and the meat. And so he's hanging there waiting for them to bring him his food every morning and every evening. I can only imagine waiting and wondering as he sat next to that shining brook. He was left in the solitude of his camp. Did he sort of replay in his mind what he had told to that ruthless king Ahab? Did he tell that story over and over in his own head again? Did he continually pinch himself to see if he really was awake and if he really had seen this or if it was just a dream? Once the brook began to dry up, God gave good old Elijah some instructions. He says, I want you to go to Zarephath. And when you get to Zarephath, you're going to meet this lady. And this lady is going to feed you. And so he goes to Zarephath in Sidon, a pagan area. Interestingly enough, it's not an area that we would deem to be important for good Jews. And he goes to this pagan area and he finds this lady who is collecting sticks. As she goes to find those sticks, interestingly enough, she's finding these sticks that she's going to build a fire and cook the last meal for her and for her son. They have only enough flour and only enough oil for one bit of bread, and it'll be their last meal together. I'm sure she's concerned about what's going to happen, and so she assumes that's all there'll be. Elijah tells her, now God has told me that you're supposed to give me the first loaf of bread that comes, and then he will provide for you all of the bread and the flour and the oil that you need from then on. And so she does exactly that. She's a lady who puts enough faith in Elijah that everything is going to work out, and she does it, and sure enough, they never run out of flour and they never run out of oil and they've got plenty to eat. Everything is going wonderfully for the two of them. They've put their trust in God and God provides for them. And so it's a wonderful story. Now, it isn't long before her son gets very ill. And in fact, it comes to the point that he can't breathe and he basically will die. And so good old Elijah will ask, let's take him to the upper room, and there we'll see what God can do. And so he lays across him, and sure enough, the breath comes back into him again, and he's alive again. And he delivers her son back to her again. Her response is, I know that you're a man from God. Because only God could do this. So things have gone rather well. But it's time for good old Elijah to move on and for something else to happen. And so in our story, the next thing in our story will be have to do with good old Ahab's wife, a lady named Jezebel, who's a big supporter of the god Baal. She's paying the way for the prophets of Baal, and there are 450 prophets of Baal, but Elijah is all by himself. Some of the other prophets of Yahweh God have been hidden away in a cave by a man named Obadiah, but it's Elijah versus 450. And so good old Elijah will go to Mount Carmel. And he is ready for a showdown. He calls for a showdown with those 450 prophets of Baal. Elijah builds an altar, and he will tell the prophets of Baal to do the same thing. You choose the spot you want. I'll choose my spot, but you choose your spot. You get to go first. You choose. And so then in the presence of Ahab, he tells the priest that the only true God will send down fire from heaven to light the altar. And so it's time to choose the oxen that they're going to put on their altar to offer. And he says, you choose first. You pick the one you want. You pick the spot you want. You pick the oxen that you want. And you kill that oxen and you put it on that altar and call to Baal to have Baal bring down fire from heaven. And I will have Yahweh to bring down fire from heaven. And so all of those prophets of Baal will cry and scream and call for Baal to do something. But nothing happens. Elijah, the lone prophet of God, mocks them all. He will say, perhaps he's deep in thought. Maybe he's gone to the restroom. Maybe he's busy. Maybe he's gone on a journey. I know, maybe he's asleep and you need to wake him up. And so he's making fun of them and making fun of their God, who isn't really a God at all. And so it's time then, they've not been able to do anything. They cut themselves, they yell, they do everything they can imagine, but nothing happens. And so it's Elijah's turn. So Elijah asked them to come and to pour water on his altar. He digs a trench all the way around it and to pour water on the altar to fill in that trench all the way around it. And they will do it. And he'll say, that's not enough. Come back and do it again. And then he'll say, that's still not enough. Do it a third time. And so they'll cover that altar with water over and over again. And then he prays to God. He says, Lord, please act so that these people will know that I know you. I want them to know that I know you. I want you to demonstrate that for them. And so God sends a fire from heaven. It consumes the bull and the wood and the stones and all of the water that's in the trenches. It's all gone. And indeed, there is fire from heaven. The people turned on the priests of Baal and slaughtered them all. And so all 450 of those prophets of Baal are killed. King Ahab goes back and reports this to his wife. Jezebel, here's what happened. And Jezebel is determined that she is going to kill our man Elijah. She sent a message to Elijah. I'm going to kill you. And Elijah was afraid, and he ran away. Hopeless and miserable, he plopped down in the desert, ready to die, and God will send an angel to feed him. Again, God provides for him. And he sent him on to Mount Sinai. It's a 40-day journey, and he'll make that 40-day journey, and God's provided for him and gives him all the strength that he needs to make it all the way for that 40-day journey. Once he's there, he finds a cave and he spends the night in a cave. God will ask him, what are you doing here? Elijah explains that he had faithfully served the Lord, but he had nothing to show for it. I mean, it's basically me versus all of those bad folks. It's me and there's nobody else. And God will say, no, there are a whole bunch of folks who haven't bowed a knee to Baal. You're not alone. And he said, I'm the only prophet left and they're going to kill me. And then God sent him to stand on the mountain. And here's this wonderful text. I want to share with you that text. Here's the calling. Here's the nice picture of the folks of prophets of Baal as they try to call down fire from heaven and nothing happens. And there on the right-hand side is Elijah calling down fire from heaven. And indeed, the whole altar is burned. Here's this wonderful text. And as Elijah stood there, the Lord passed by. A mighty windstorm hit the mountain. And it was a terrible blast, and the rocks were torn loose, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. I love this part of the text. Here's good old Elijah looking out from his cave and seeing and hearing all of these things. He first of all hears this windstorm, but God's not in the wind. And then there's an earthquake, and God's not in the earthquake. And then there's a fire, a raging fire, and God is not in the fire. And so good old Elijah will be there. After the fire, there was a sound, a gentle whisper. Then Elijah heard it, and he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance to the cave. So good old Elijah will go to the entrance to the cave. God will ask him again, "What are you doing here?" It's really interesting. God has asked him three times that very question. What are you doing here? It's a rhetorical question. God knows exactly what it is. Basically, God is trying to teach him a lesson. He will say, "Do you remember that I fed you during that drought, when there was the drought? I had those ravens to come and feed you. Don't you remember that? I fed you. And do you remember when you went to Zarephath and there was not enough flour and oil, but I made sure there was plenty for you and for the widow and for her son? And how you even raised her son from the dead? Do you remember those occasions? Do you remember going to Mount Carmel? And do you remember that fire that I sent down? Do you remember how I gave you enough food to travel through the desert and to come to this mountain? Don't you remember any of that? Aren't you mindful of what's happening here?" I think it's an important lesson for good old Elijah. It's easy because, you see, he's expected God in those big grand things, but he doesn't expect what's going to happen because God is going to speak to him in a little quiet voice. God will speak to him in a quiet voice. He wasn't in the wind, and he wasn't in the earthquake, and he wasn't in the fire, but he speaks to Elijah with a small, quiet voice. I think we may need to hear the small, quiet voice of the Lord. When we don't get the answer that we're expecting, we need to realize that. The time of the quarantine is our time to remember that we've been fed by ravens. God has met our needs. He always meets our needs. We need to focus on times God has provided for us. When Elijah had a belly full of God's provisions, he was able to stand up to 450 angry pagan priests. And we live in a time which is pretty angry and a pretty gruesome time. We may not get the answer that we expect, the way we expect. It may not be in some kind of grand way. It may not be fire sent on an altar. It may not be in a wind or an earthquake or a big fire. Heaven knows we have a time now, though, to listen to the Lord. And so we need to open our ears and hear the whisper of God. I think God, in a very real way, is speaking to us in a time like this. We've been very fortunate, most of us, not to have that terrible disease. And for some folks who are listening, they may have had the disease and already recovered from it. But again, there's this quiet whisper of God. God is at work, and we need to listen to what He's saying to us. I think there's a lesson for us to learn. It's easy for us to take for granted all that God has done for us. He's blessed us in so many ways, and we take that for granted. We fail to remember the wonderful blessings, fail to remember that we've been fed by ravens, And we don't realize that indeed God is with us always. At a time like this, it's important for us to reflect on the fact that indeed our God is with us, and He will bless us. He'll come to our aid, and He'll rescue us when we need it most. May we think through these issues. I hope you'll read through this story, and you might like to read through all of 1 Kings chapter 17 and 18 to get the story that I've just told you, but to get that story and to put it in place. I hope that you'll find the story worthwhile and that it will make sense to you in a very real way, and that we'll hear God speaking to us in ways that we sometimes don't think, even today. Thank you.
Pardon for sin and death.